I'm one of the reference and instruction librarians here at Seattle Central College Library. So we hold this series in the library every week because we believe it is an extension of our charge to promote the freedom of information and open exchange of ideas. So whether or not you read every single thing you hear in this room today, or read in one of the books that are available to check out up here, or find in our databases, we want you to have access to a wide range of viewpoints so that you can learn and grow. In the same vein, as we're having conversation today, if any questions come up, I hope that we'll remain respectful of each other and this space, and recognize that we're all here for discussion and learning. So, next week, we will be having Melanie King, Seattle Central College faculty member, who will be leading a conversation around cultural appropriation and recognizing and rectifying it. But today, please join me in welcoming Michael Vincente Perez, who is a UW Anthropology senior lecturer, as he discusses with us collective memory and violence. So Michael, thank you.
Thanks. I think I did this once before, several years ago, actually. I think we did something about Islam and the United States or something. So it's nice to actually be back with you. It was done in this very room, if I'm not mistaken. So today I'm going to do something with you that I teach about. I have a class that I teach every year, and it's called Collective Memory and Violence. It's an anthropology course. And in fact, some of the texts that you see here I've actually used for the class. But for those of you who have no idea what this is about, I'm going to try to lead a sort of brief introduction of what this is about, and then open the floor for an exchange to see what might be some of the implications of this, why we think this may matter. It's obviously a pretty large subject. It has a lot of varying opinions about how to approach it. Nonetheless, I'm just going to give you some sort of bare bones ways of understanding the way that some people talk about collective memory and how it connects with violence, and then we can sort of explore together what the maybe implications are, as often the interest in collective memory violence is, in fact, that there are implications for usually more violence, or hopefully something different, but we'll get to that. All right, so I'm just going to walk you through a bit of a PowerPoint that might help here, right? So what is a collective memory, and what is the, quote, collective in memory, right? This is a sort of challenging. Maybe it's not challenging. Maybe we have an intuitive sense of what collective memory is. Does somebody want to just sort of give me an idea about what a collective memory is? And I could give you one proposal, and you could tell me whether you think this is a collective, this is the right approach here, right? Is it just, say, a bunch of people, we all have the same memory of, say, lightning striking outside. Do we have a collective memory? We were all here, we all saw it, now we recall it. Is that really what we're talking about when we're talking about collective memory? I mean, my intonation sort of are.
Yes.
But the answer is no, right? It's not one, the kind of memory we're interested in when we're talking about collective memory is not one that's necessarily about a bunch of people who happen to have seen or experienced the same thing and then have a memory of it in whatever various iterations it might have. That's actually not sufficient for what we're thinking about when we're thinking about collective memory. So what are we thinking about? Well, when we're thinking about collective memory, we're thinking about the implications that memories have or the links that memories have with particular groups. So when we're talking about collective, we're thinking about the concept of collective in a socially specific way. And what that means is that we're thinking in terms of what we call social groups. So I don't mean just a group of people who saw a bunch of lightning strike the earth. I'm talking about a group of people that, because they have a shared identification, a sort of socially recognized identity, if you want to put it that way, and who share memories about the past and are somewhat unique to that particular group of people. And we're going to build this up a little bit, since this is just one of the first steps. But when we're thinking about, say, a social group, we're thinking about something like family, the idea of nation. Now, as an anthropologist, I'm very weary of simply treating groups as sort of real things. We tend to be more interested in how people experience and identify in terms of groups, what makes groupness, if you will, possible. So when I say something like nation, my vision of nation is that it's a contested term, and it's about different ways that people sort of claim an identity, right? And there are always sort of multiple ways of doing that. But when we're talking about social groups, generally what we're talking about are categories categories of shared identity, whether it be nation, be a religious group, family, an actual family, or whatever. This is what we need. So we all see lightning, but we don't have a social identity as a result of that. It's not implicated. It may be, it could be, but it's typically, we could say, it's not implicated in our identities as a group. It's just that we're a group precisely because we saw the lightning bolt, but that's not a really socially meaningful groupness, right? Because it doesn't implicate us in anything outside of the fact that we saw the lightning walk away and we all have the memory, great, but there's no, we're not a nation because of it, and it doesn't constitute, we'd say, right, the sense of nationhood that we have. Although many sort of tragedies end up doing, lightning maybe is one sort of tragedy, right? Depending where it hits. So when we're talking about collective memory, then we're talking about shared communications about the past and shared meanings of the past. Now, the two are not necessarily separable because meaning, we don't just have sort of neutral memories floating around, really. We begin to articulate memories, we're narrativizing, we're giving them meaning, they have meaning for us. Now, there are some variations. Trauma is a very sort of different experience, but I'm not going to really deal with trauma. But for the most part, you know, we're talking about communications about what has happened and a meaning that has that's embedded within those communications about the past. So, and they don't just relate to me, these memories that I communicate. They don't just relate to me, although they relate to me. They relate to an entire group of people, right? As whatever that group may be, as family, right? If you imagine, I tell a story in my, I'm in a family gathering, and I tell a story about a memory that we all have, and that memory is shared by the family, and it gives the sense of familyness in a way, because we all share it, and it's meaningful to us as a group, right? It sort of makes possible a group and reinforces the sense in which we already are a group, if that makes sense. So it's just, so this is kind of one of the ways we're thinking about this. So it means that collective memories are memories of people who remember a certain event that, although it may be expressed by individuals, in a sense belongs to more than an individual, belongs to a particular group or pertains to the group. So I have this picture here of Calle Ocho in Miami, which is, I'm from Miami and I'm Cuban, and Calle Ocho is a Cuban-American space. And so as an example, right, so if I have a memory about my struggles finding work, and I'm just giving you a hypothetical. Finding work in Miami as a Cuban, right? And I identify as a member of the Cuban-American community of Little Havana. This is what we call Little Havana in Miami. I may communicate that memory to other Cuban-Americans as both my individual memory, but also a memory of all Cuban-Americans who have struggled to find work in the United States as an immigrant community, right? So I understand that memory, how I understand that memory of looking for work and how I communicate it may be individual, but it's ultimately what we'd say socially framed, meaning that it'll work within the idea of being a Cuban American in Miami, and it's a memory that isn't simply mine, but that other Cuban Americans can identify with and have a sense that we're both belonging, or we're belonging together in this group called Cuban American, right? So it is an individual memory in a sense, but it's related to a group, and it's not merely individual. It's shared insofar as I identify in terms of Cuban-American, and frame it in a sense according to that, that memory. This may become a little bit more clear. We're going to work through a few examples, right? So this means that a lot of our memories are really socially framed. And a lot of the work that comes out of collective memory studies is really looking at this, what we call the social nature of memory. How we remember, what we remember, when and where we remember, and how we articulate those remembrances are deeply implicated in a kind of social, there's a social component to it. It's not merely me individually talking about what's happened. There's something social about this, and I'll hopefully this become clear in a second. So we say that memories then, in a sense, that are collective are socially framed. They're referred to often as the social frameworks of memory, and there are a lot of authors who whose work you look at, and what they're looking for are, what are the social frameworks that metaphorically frame the way people remember as members of groups. So this, we're attentive to the social framing of things that people recall and how those are implicated in the sense of group. So individual memories bear the values, we say, and they bear the ideas of particular groups, and they contribute to the sense in which the group of it is in fact an individual and how people identify with them. Okay. All right.
So memories recalled, though, another interesting aspect of collective memory and this point of social frameworks is that when we remember, we do so in the present. We may be recalling something about the past, but we're always recalling in a present context. And why that matters is that the social frameworks that memories have are structured, in a sense, by the historical context in which the memories are told. What that means is groups don't stay the same over time. They don't remain the same over time. They have different experiences, and those experiences are assimilated into the group or whatever, and the meaning of groups can change over time. We know that. That means that the social frameworks of groups will also change, and that means that the memories and the meanings of memories will change as well. That they'll change over time as the sense of what the group's values are change over time as well. And so the frameworks change for memory. So when we're looking at collective memory, what's interesting, and there's a lot of work on this, that can kind of point to the ways that a particular social group at one point in history remembers something in a certain way. After a certain period of time, decades or whatever, there's a different sense of what that memory means now, and there's almost a different sense, there's a different framework for making sense of those memories. And one way to think about it simply, and I'll give you an example, but I mean, the sense of a memory, the memory of a group that has experienced genocide in the aftermath of genocide, and then say several decades later, a new generation is born, some process has happened where what we call transitional justice has taken place, and people have talked about the violence, and there have been these processes for people to kind of speak about what's happened. After that, after all of those experiences, the memories of the genocide might change. They may have new meanings for the group. It's still the same group in a sense, but the group's changed in a way in relation to that event. And so you could look at two group memories, two collective memories at two different points in history and see that they're kind of different. They're not necessarily the same because things have been changing. Historical context, the present context of talking about memory has changed. So that means that our social frameworks of memory are historical, so we have to pay attention to what the context is in which people remember certain things. And it bears the frameworks of our memories bear a kind of historical meaning. They're grounded in a particular context. So let me just give you a simple, this is a very simplistic example, but I've got two images here that hopefully relate in a sense to what I'm doing. So let's say I'm a Vietnam veteran. And I've just returned from the war not too long after the war. And I'm in a group of other Vietnam vets. And we all meet like this, in a sense, we do every week or whatever. And we have a social identity as Vietnam veterans. We went through experiences that gave us that sort of sense of a groupness. And we're all telling our stories about the war or whatever. But this group of veterans believes the war was just, that it was a legitimate fight against the spread of communism. It was a legitimate defense of democracy, freedom, and all the other ways, the thing, values that people might want to assign to the war or whatever. And so when I talk about my memories of the war, my memories are in a sense framed by the meanings that I have in this group of veterans who believes that what happened may have been brutal, but it was a good thing. And I'll talk about those memories and maybe even recall them in a sense that gives them a value that's positive or that lines up with this sense that I think it was a legitimate war and it was painful and there was a lot of suffering, but it was nonetheless a righteous cause in a sense. Right? And that memory helps my individual memories framed by this sense of the group helps reproduce the sense of a group that we're all a part of. You all share the same sort of sense of what these things mean, and you'll tell your stories according to those values and those meanings as well. You'll frame your memories according to the framework of a group of veterans that shares the sense that the war was just a war. Or, and I use the picture on the left here to kind of try to give you that sense, like here you have this seemingly like soldier, maybe, I don't know exactly what's going on, but one could see it as like this soldier feels that they're doing good and they're helping somebody. And then you have this picture, which is famous photos, I believe it's napalm bombing and impact on children during the war. Well, now, 10 years after the war, maybe 20, I start to migrate towards a different sort of group of veterans. And we're really questioning the war now. This group of veterans has a sense of identity that sees us as tools of American empire. And that we were sent to an unjust war. And we were sent there to fight a war that we shouldn't have been a part of, and we killed a lot of innocent people, and we had no right in doing so, and we killed a lot of ourselves in the process, etc. now some sets of values or whatever are shared in this group, or this collective of veterans. And now my memories are a little different, because now I have a different social framework for thinking about what my experiences were. And my experience is not just as an experience of me, but an experience as a veteran, a person who fought in this war, who was used by the US government to pursue essentially capitalist imperialism instead of really fighting a just war. So now my memories are different. I mean, I still recall things, but I recall things with a sense of a different, we'd say, imprint on those memories that are framed by my membership and relationship with the group that I'm a part of. And all those memories then reinforce the values that the group has as a group of veterans opposed to the war, essentially. Right? This is a very simplistic example. I mean, it gets much more complicated. But at any rate, the point should be hopefully clear, right? That as a group changes over time, or as I change membership in groups, if you want to put it that way, then I have different social frameworks for those groups, and those social frameworks impact or shape and affect the way I think about memories and experiences that I've had. And in fact, affects them in such a way that I remember in ways that relate to the ideas and values shared by that group that I'm a part of. And so memory then is something that's happening in the present, and in a sense it's highly dependent in many ways on the present. And we say that collective memories are essentially a present version of the past. Right? Because if the social does impact the way we recall to the extent that some say, then although we may recall things of the past, because they're recalled in the present, there's always a sense of a present iteration of a past claim or a past experience or whatever. Now, of course, that means that this, what we're talking about is that collective memory is deeply implicated in identity. They're inseparable, and many times what people are looking at when they're looking at collective memory is the ways that the memories that are collected are part of the process of group formation and group identity. So the social frameworks of our memories are implicated then in how we identify as a group and disidentify with other groups, because if I'm part of this group with these memories, you don't have those memories, you're not part of the group in a sense. You didn't experience it, you don't have that shared sense, that shared experience, you don't have the shared memory, you're not part of the collective, you're not part of the group. So in a sense, people read this as an analogy of the individual. You all have individual memories, and you know yourselves as a consistent self. Like, tomorrow you can wake up and go, who am I? What's going on? And part of that is because you have memories that enable you to experience a sense of continuity across time. So people take this and use it analogously to say that that's the same way memory works for groups, that the memories of individuals that are implicated in groups makes possible the sense that a group is living across space and time consistently. And they use this analogy of individual memory for collective memory. And this is at least one of the arguments about it. All right. Now, the reason people are interested in collective memory violence is because often groups have a collective memory of very violent episodes. That violence, in a sense, is often very much a part of the very meaning of the group that one may be a member of. So violence is deeply implicated in the identity of groups. Groups often have narratives about origin, narratives of origin that have to do with violence, narratives of loss that have to do with violence, and narratives of recovery that have to do with violence. So members of the groups may recall these events and feel them as their own memories of their own identity and as individual members of the group. They may be episodes of violence that are considered heroic, and thus recalled heroically by the group, that strengthen the values of the group being heroic, defiant, powerful, whatever it may be. Or they may be episodes of violence that are considered victimizing, right? And then are recalled through conceptions of innocence and suffering and give meaning to the group as a victimized group, for example. Depends, we have various ways that groups sort of tend to think about the violence they've experienced or recall having experienced in the past. And those things may change over time. Well, I guess myself mentioned. So, I mean, one can think very easily about the American settler colonial project in the United States. You can think about indigenous communities and the very meaning, say, of indigenous identity in the United States or a Native American identity is, in a sense, inseparable from the colonial violence of the founding of the United States. the group, the very meaning of the identity of people who identify as Indigenous and Native American often have memories, not that they themselves experience, but of a past in which their ancestors or their people were violently oppressed by the processes of American settler colonialism, the European settler colonialism. And so what it means to be then a member of an Indigenous community or Native community is to be a community that has historic victimization. And one, even though I myself may not have experienced that violence, my ancestors did, and I feel it's my memory, it's my violence, and it's violence that still that impacted me and shaped what it means to be the person that I am today. Right? And you can think about the Trail of Tears, right? Where Andrew Jackson's policy of removal and forces the Cherokee Nation to resettle in present-day Oklahoma. Over 4,000 out of 15,000 Cherokees died in that process. It's hard to imagine how, in a sense, the Trail of Tears is not constitutive of, it's not a memory constitutive of that identity being Cherokee. In other words, being Cherokee is sort of inseparable in some ways. It's not dependent on that one thing. Violence isn't always the one story, but it's part of the story that sort of makes up the group of Cherokee. It's recalled across generations. And so this is, in a sense, a pretty simple illustration of how violence can be implicated in the sense of the group that we participate in. You could also think about genocide, and many people who work on collective memory and violence look at genocide, they look at post-genocidal context. Say for Rwandans, memories of the genocide are probably quite constitutive of the identities of victimization and victims and even perpetrators. So it's not always that memories of violence necessarily make you mark you as a victim. You can have groups whose identity is in a sense shaped by their perpetrator, their perpetrating of violence in the past. So it's not always, we don't always want to read this in terms of victimization. And so memories of violence are then examples of collective memory, and they're very critical for understanding how groups identify as a particular group. So the meaning of those memories of violence will change across time, of course, as we just mentioned, and so the memories of violence, they're not singular. They're never a singular meaning. They have different meanings across time. And one more thing that I'll point to before I go to the next slide, which will kind of invite for you for a discussion on this, is that a lot of times too, when people look at collective memory, they're looking at the conflict with history. I mean, there may be a temptation to just replace it with the word memory with history in a sense, and that's a very complex debate, but we can ignore it for now. But one of the ways that people look at memory is, let's say, you know, history is the official production of a story about the past that also is implicated in identity, right? The story of the American nation. You read it where? Well, you read it in a textbook when you go to school, in elementary school or whatever, and there's a story about the American people, who they are, what experiences they have, etc. Often when people look at collective memory, they're looking at communities whose histories are not included in the official history. Sometimes they'll refer to it as popular memory, sometimes they refer to it as cultural memory, sometimes they refer to it as just collective memory, but there's an interest of power in the ways that group identities have their own recollections of a past that matters to their sense of who they are in the present, but who have been excluded from official stories about larger groups or whatever it may be. And so one thing to sort of look at is so the tension between history and memory in this regard, but also to be attentive that how a memory becomes collective is also an enactment of power. So just as power can exclude the story of memories of certain groups in the writing of history just by not including their perspective or their experience, there's also groups that have their own dynamics that can suppress memories within them as well. So there's a trap that sometimes people fall into, which is to say that there's a collective memory, then we assume that everybody's on board. No, actually we try to look at the ways, when we study this, we also try to look at the ways that groups are sort of in tension within themselves about what the past means and who wins, in a sense. How a particular memory comes to have the more dominant meaning in a group, and where there may be existing contradictions within that group. People who identify with it, but nonetheless have a different feeling or sense about the meaning of that past that's shared within the group. So we're always interested in power. we're not simply, we don't simply look at this as everybody has the same memory, it all means the same thing, and it's totalizing, and that's it. It's a done deal. You're all a member of the American nation, and you all have the same right. No, we look at the contradictions and challenges, and we look at the different levels of power that exist. You know, who gets to tell their story? What becomes official? What is unofficial? And then we also want to think about how that's implicated in either the possibilities for peace or the possibilities for war violence. So one of the reasons you do truth commissions, for example, following large-scale violence like the apartheid of South Africa, where they instituted the first truth commission committee, was to give voice to people whose voices weren't going to be heard, and to hopefully build a sense of a collective memory about the tragedy of apartheid that brought more people together rather than producing the differences between people. And so you have, and now in other cases you have, say, governments that, I'll give you an example, say Lebanon, where they had a civil war for almost two decades, I think, but it ended in the 1990s, but this was a highly violent event, the civil war, and the state decides, well, look, there were no victors and there were no vanquished, was the sort of slogan that the state used, the government used. So in that case, they said, we're not going to try to talk about the past, because if we do, we're just going to have more conflict. So what they did is the state's approach was what we call a policy of forced amnesia. Everyone can't talk about the war. There is no official story about the Civil War. We're just going to move on. Now, in some cases, maybe that works, maybe not. It's highly dependent. But in Lebanon, people haven't forgotten. And the violence, the forced amnesia that's supposed to happen in the country hasn't actually worked, in the sense that people still remember violence and have no forum to talk about that violence in a way that might disrupt the effect it had in separating people. You would want, for example, that's one of the reasons people want truth commissions, is that if people can talk about the violence and perpetrators and victims can understand each other, then there's the potential for a sense of groupness to change, and for those memories to become less potential for future violence. But if you suppress it, well, what you may have is, well, okay, so there, you know, my story's been forgotten, and I remember that you did something to me and to my people, so what am I going to do? I'm going to get you back. And so often you find that collective memories of violence can be implicated in further violence. And that's one of the reasons that, again, people want to look at this, is to try to find ways to deal with that so that we don't have the reproduction of violence. Because if you're a community who has a collective memory of violence suffering at the hands of another community that you still live with, then you may, in fact, have the potential for violence to happen. And in fact, that's what happened in Rwanda with the Hutu genocide against the Tutsi. The Tutsi actually had also committed genocide against Hutu in Burundi in the 1970s, and there were a lot of tensions and implications in these group identities that then were politically exacerbated and produced, arguably, the genocide. And there were memories of previous violence. I mean, people wanted to talk about this is just tribal violence. No, there was memory of violence that had happened in these, that was implicated in the formation of these identities that had to do with colonialism and other things, but there was a previous genocide. And then that was implicated in the new genocide. And then violence comes then to work as a hardening of our identities and difference, right? Once I enact violence on you as a member of another group, I'm reinforcing the sense in which you are that group and I'm not. And so this is what we try to do. So we think about this to try to disrupt the reproductions and cycles of violence that exist as people unfortunately have memories collectively about mass suffering, be it genocide or whatever. And so as a kind of invitation to see, have you participate in this a little bit, and we can talk about anything that I've said, as a matter of fact, but I thought about, 9/11. I teach the whole section on 9/11 in my class because it's so important in various ways. And I think it's an interesting example of the tension around whose memory is it, how is it remembered, and how is it implicated in particular ideas about social groups. So I'll come back to this slide in a second, but so I just want to show you, there's an offensive word here, but I wanted to show you this thing because I thought this is an interesting example, right? So you have a picture of the towers, fresh after the planes hit them, And this is what the meme said, but go ahead and ask us if we give two shits about the refugee van. Who is the us that's being implicated here? I mean, is it American? How are they remembering 9/11? And how are they linking it now to some justification for what we may consider as another form of violence, which is the banning of refugees coming from the United States? Right? So this stuff is operating all the time, and 9/11 is a very important memory that's put to a lot of uses, right? I think, and I would argue, it's put to a lot of uses. And so we really have to be sort of critical about how that memory works to form and support what sense of group, who's excluded, and what other ways might we remember 9/11 that could produce potentially less disastrous futures. So these are just some questions, right? Who's collective memory? Is 9/11 a collective memory? Is it a single collective memory, more than one? Who is the collective? Are there different collectives? What meaning does 9/11 have for the collective? What social framework for 9/11 can you identify? How does it relate to your social group identity? So because I only have 20 minutes, I think I'll let you mull this over for a second. We can talk about this, or I can answer also just general questions that, about the talk, and hopefully this has been of some use to you. So, and I guess a question and answer, or we can take this on. One thing to do when we study collective memory, and this is the reason some people call it cultural memory as well, is look at what we call cultural productions of memory. In other words, memory is not simply what's in my head or whatever. Memory is also in the artifacts I may produce that reference those pasts, right? So this is a kind of cultural memory in the sense that the meme is a very cultural artifact. And people are putting, in a sense, the memory of 9/11 into a cultural artifact that we consume. Films are also productive of what we call collective memory. So there are various ways that collective memory is produced, and some people study the way, you know, memoirs, paintings, different forms of art that contribute to the sense of group experience and give meaning to the memories that groups share. So we also look at those things. We don't just simply look at testimony where people sit. We look at other aspects of this.
Yeah. It was an interesting lecture. I liked it. I have a question concerning about the history and the memory.
Yeah.
The first question is, how does it help, or can we say it's a positive impact to the community or a negative impact to the community? For example, we talk a lot about, even during an English class, for example, it's linked to a history of the United States. People who come here, even though they don't want or whether they want, they just have to learn the history of America and the slavery and everything, or by any chance you can see. So is that an important thing, or how does it produce to the community? Is it a positive or a negative?
I don't know that it, you know, what that I can say whether it's always going to be positive or negative. But if I understand you asking, say, I come to the States and now I'm reading the story of the American people in the official textbooks, right, or literature class or whatever, right, the cultural products that are supposed to be American, say Ralph Waldo Emerson, and I read him and I feel like he's part of me and we're part of a shared community, I'm American, he's American. And then I come from Cuba and I'm reading this stuff, I mean, it's a good question because it's sort of about how I'm inducted in a way into the idea of Americans. And will this effectively help me then identify with the memories that whoever Americans are have of the past, and whether I feel them and they belong to me too, and I belong to this group because now that thing, I feel like it's part of my story as well. It's kind of hard because, I mean, I'm Cuban-American. I was born here, but my parents are from Cuba. And I don't have any ancestral history here. You know, my ancestral history is in Cuba. So I read all those textbooks, and I still don't have a clear sense of my relationship to the American nation as a group. And I can't look at the history as a sort of memory of my people, because my memory, the people that I identify with, history is somewhere else.
Well, I'm sorry to talk.
Yeah, no, please.
What I'm trying to frame is, for for example, not only if you are from a foreigner, let's say, for example, you are from that particular group or people that you, that's in a collective, how does a native, like slavery, when you're teaching people slavery, how does it help? Okay, we know that it teaches about what happened and the violence, but throughout your experience, since this is you have experience in this field, can we say it's positive to learn violences and slavery, and how do they contribute to the community?
So it depends. I mean, there's a great book by a guy named, I think it's Chuck Alexander, about the cultural trauma of slavery. And his argument, in a sense, is that slavery hasn't been adequately addressed in a way that really brings the story of African-American and white Euro-American into a shared picture. That the way it's taught still it doesn't meet the sense of trauma and violence that is, I think the word is a little sort of abstract here, but that's constituted what it means to be African-American. And because the stories that are being told are not actually doing justice to the sense of what this community is as Americans, then it's failing to produce a larger groupness in which white Euro-Americans and African-Americans can really see this as a shared past that doesn't divide them. I mean, it's clearly a shared past, but it's not a past that they can that can be easily identified as bringing us together and that we're maybe healing and moving on from, right? And so the way it seems to me is that it's, unless it's done well, which means that if you're gonna produce official histories of slavery, you need to start consulting different ways that African-American communities think about slavery so that they feel their memories of this, in a way, are included in the narrative. Not me being a sort of abstracted historian writing the textbook and picking whatever I think is relevant, but understanding what it means to be Black American and then including what the senses of memories are of slavery for this community into the official history in a way that helps perhaps produce a greater sense of healing, and that we're at a point where Americanness can, we're healed and we can encompass, we can see each Americanness as encompassing us both, and that violence is no longer necessarily divisive, but productive of something else. We don't know what that is yet, because I don't think that they've done a good job in producing narratives about slavery that can actually overcome the ways that those memories are dividing. Does that make sense? Does that help a little bit?
That makes sense. Throughout my experiences, I came to know that all the memories that we see are totally negative. If you switch on the TV and you listen a song, it talks about a very horrible, destructive. It talks about like failing love or something like that. You go to the news, you hear another horrible story. You go to the priest of the sheikh, and then you hear about the hell and, you know, and bad things. So why is it that every memory or every history is changing to a negative? It's like the negative things making more sense to tell than the positive thing, which creates a lot of hardship to the people that wants to listen something or to listen.
Unfortunately, yeah. Right. I mean, I'm Muslim, and I think to myself that every day the stories produced in some sense on the news, and the news is doing a better job lately, but the ways that the media produces stories about Islam and Americans keeps producing a divide. And so, for example, an event like the Orlando shootings, which were terrible, that memory produces a sense of Americanness and shared victimization. It could have been anybody, and these were Americans, and I'm American, whatever. But then you have, say, the Quebec shooting, where Muslims were killed by a white man, and that story doesn't have the same effect. It makes me feel, how would I put it? The ways that violence is told gives me a sense that there's the violence that Americans face and Muslims are not a part of that community. And then we, as Muslims, then start to recall and think about and have memories of events that affected us that are consistently excluded from the story of American victimization, right? So 9/11, it was indiscriminate killing, right? Pretty simply, right? Straightforward. They killed everybody, not a particular group, and they killed them as Americans, and whoever was in that building, whether they were undocumented workers or not, and there were plenty of marginalized people in these buildings, you know, they were all killed the same way. And yet, for some reason, I see that there's a racialized sense of the American people that emerges after 9/11, and it's a sense that particularly certain groups of white Americans feel that they were directly victimized. The fact that Muslims died in that building too doesn't matter. In fact, on the contrary, Muslims are the group that are killing us, right? And so it's really tricky and frustrating to watch how identity is produced in the ways, in these stories about violence that give life to the divisions instead of life to the, I mean, there are people pushing back and have been, and I don't want to overtell this one story here. I mean, I do think that people are really struggling to produce different ways of accounting for this stuff that brings us together. But, you know, it's hard. It's very hard to do that work. I hope that answers your question. It's a quite a big thing to think about. Are there any other questions or thoughts? Yeah.
I was interested in the fourth point in this, what social framework for 9/11 can you identify? Could you elaborate what does that mean?
Yeah, I mean, there are different ways that 9/11 is framed, and in a sense, the even calling it 9/11 is already a framing, but there are different ways that 9/11 is framed. And so there was a good paper that looked at sort of post 9/11 narratives right after. And for some, say, the memory of 9/11 is the memory of Americans being victimized, our innocence. So we value ourselves, whoever identify in this sense of Americanness, identify Americanness as American group as being a good group of people, innocent, and we were innocently attacked that day by the violence of Muslims in particular. And so then the framing of that impacts what happens next, right? We were just doing our daily business and we were attacked, and now we have to respond by war to defend ourselves because this may happen again. But another social framing, another narrative that emerged is that, well, this shows that we're not innocent. The American people are not innocent, and that they have to take stock now of the violence we've committed consistently as a group of people, and that it eventually comes back at you. And so these people would say we need to think about 9/11 as an opportunity to redefine what American people, who the American people are, such that we're no longer implicated in violence that is indefensible, assuming that there's some defensible and non-defensible forms of violence. And these were debates. There were two social frameworks. So for some, the memory of 9/11, you know, is a memory of the exposure of American violence and sort of the historical effect of a long trajectory of American imperial aggression. For others, it's the violence of Muslim civilization, the clash of civilization coming to its head, and it's the opening, it's the moment of American innocence realized by our victimization on our own homeland. And you do have people who think about 9/11 in these ways. And one of the things I do in my class is look at the different representations in film, in graphic novels, in the memorial. Memorials are often sites of conflict over memories because memorials are supposed to sort of commemorate an event. But the question is, how is it commemorated? Who does it seem to commemorate in what ways? But that's what I mean by what social frameworks are. What are the social meanings of the American people that come to frame the way this event is recalled by folks? And it clearly it has, there are various ways of doing that, and it has deep implications for what's followed, right? If you're of the American innocence side of that, you might say, well then our violence is completely justified in Afghanistan or whatever. And if you're not, you might say, no, the violence is not justified precisely because this is what got us to 9/11 in the first place, you know what I mean? So that's kind of what I'm thinking about in that moment. Yeah.
So, can you say the life we went through, the memory to have an advantage or disadvantage on the life we are living now?
It could, you know, for some people it's a sense of solidarity, which is important, and it's a sense of, depending on the meanings, right? So maybe in past experiences and memories of violence enable a sense of resilience in a community. We've been through this before, we've struggled before, we've always been struggling, and we're gonna keep struggling, we're not gonna give up kind of thing. So there are different ways that communities think about what's happened to them, and it may produce positive forms of solidarity, meaning that there's no there's no vengeance, for example, implicated, right? So we have a history, we have a memory of violence that came to sort of mark us as a group, but it doesn't compel us to commit more violence. It just compels us to think about ourselves as a group and needing each other and having solidarity and struggling together and helping one another as a group, which, you know, you can find within Jewish narratives of suffering, for example, right? Jews as a community have experienced collective forms of violence and suffering in the past, and it gives a sense of resolution and community and thriving, and it can have very positive effects in some ways. On the other hand, it could have negative effects, right? Which is that, which I would argue, and I work in the Palestinian-Israeli conflict quite a bit, that's where my research is, and I would argue that in some cases, those narratives and experiences and memories of violence of Jewish suffering in the past have been used to legitimize violence against Palestinians in the past. So it really does, it can happen in different ways. Violence doesn't always produce a sense of negative reaction. It could be a source of strength if people are now in a different circumstance and look back at that violence from a different relationship to it, and now it can do something different for them, like do solidarity, community support, and help strengthen the resolve of people to go through hardships.
So it depends on how we understand or how we accept
them. It depends on how the social framework of memory emerges, who shapes it, and what it comes to mean for the people who then have it. It could go in various directions. And that's why we're attentive to power, right? Because in some cases you have, you know, somebody like this, I think, is abusing memory to tying into this idea that us as the American people who were attacked, and somehow the meaning of the community that we are is now going to stop refugees from coming. They're not even related, but whatever, it doesn't matter. It's like it's giving meaning to a sense of Americanness that's very violent and unproductive, right? And then the question is, people are struggling over what the frameworks are for 9/11. If you look at the story of the memorial, for example, and memorials are good places to study this, you see the conflicts over memory, and you see the ways that say, This is a memorial for the American people, yet you have different meanings of the American people, different groups identifying, contesting what Americanness means. And so, you know, and that was a big debate over the Vietnam memorial, for example. And because some wanted a sort of more standard, heroic memorial. If you go to D.C., if you ever go to Washington, D.C., look at the difference of the Vietnam memorial to the other memorials. Very different. The other memorials are grand, you have very large figures, so they in scale they're bigger, they're of great men, and they're typically of men, and there are these heroic scenes that give a sense of positive value and sacrifice to the story of war of the American people. The Vietnam Memorial doesn't do any of that. It's the names of the people, it's individualized, it's a completely different experience and concept, but there's great work on this. And memorials will show you how the conflicts over what the group is take place, and how memory is at the heart of that. You know, some people say that memorial of Vietnam signifies the shame that the American people feel over the war, and they fought against it because they wanted a more heroic statement about the past. Ultimately, this memorial won, and there's a very interesting kind of reaction to it. So, but memorials are a great place to see how groups struggle over the meaning of the group and how memory is an important factor for them.
Even if you forget the truth is hard, because right now we can see media have the power to identify people. It depends on media. Sometimes they exaggerate it. Sometimes they hide the truth. So we are following 75% of us, we are following the media, but not the rules. So how can we change this community with this powerful media? If we can take the rules for the community, they don't, even the people cannot understand you, but because they saw the other thing, my brother explained. So this are effect on our life, our community. So what we have to do on this one? This is my question always. So how can we understand the truth even to live in the community? We are afraid each other. We scare each other when we go God's side, everything. So those are all effects on our life, like 9/11, single mistake, but still nothing on our life. So how can we say for this topic, I don't know, as my conclusion for me.
I mean, it's a struggle, and power, it depends who has the power, it's a sort of, who has more power to say what, how we're supposed to remember 9/11, but we can also refuse it, and we do, and we have different senses of the concept of the American people that we struggle over. You know, I won't let others take the concept of the American people away from me enough that they get to say what 9/11 meant. And I think it's really a matter of just struggling for finding the more productive ways of remembering violence that are grounded in healing. Just, you know, the 9/11, one of the reactions was, let's heal through more violence. By beating them now, we're gonna somehow rectify the suffering. But that's usually not how healing takes place. That only produces more violence. So we have to emphasize ways of remembering that are focused more on healing and bridging communities rather than dividing them. Easier said than done. I wish I had the, you know, the, all these books tend to show you how complicated it is, unfortunately. All right, well, thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
I really appreciate you welcoming me here.
Thank you for coming and sharing your knowledge, and I know you gave me a lot to think about, and probably other folks too. I handed out a very brief survey that I'd love to get back to hear what else you'd be interested in learning more about, who we can host here, and how we can make this interesting and relevant to you. We also have students who do this, so if you're interested and passionate about a topic, come talk to me. We can get you on the schedule. But one more time, thank you so much, Mike.